So I would like to mention that this is a joint work with Tiangong Kui from Monash University. And yeah, so in this talk, I'm going to talk about a method to reduce the dimension of your Bayesian inverse problem. And here I'm going to talk about the dimension of the parameter, not of the data, as you're used to do in ABC. The way I'm going to do it is in a data-free way. Okay, this will become clear in a minute. So just the first slide to introduce some notations here. So we consider a Bayesian inverse problem where the goal is to infer a parameter x from a noisy observation of some forward model g of x. Okay, so the data is y, same notation as usual, right? And well, in a Bayesian setting, what you really care about is the posterior distribution, okay, that I denote by pi pos, indexed by y, all right? And it is the product of likelihood times the prior. And in this context, what you typically want to do is to draw a sample from the posterior distribution or find the map estimate, the point that maximizes the posterior density. Or more generally, you want to compute some integral over the posterior. All right. For all the existing algorithm, there is one the major issue is the dimension of the problem. And what we typically observe is that the standard algorithm, for example, you can think of your MCMC algorithm, right? It actually suffers, or it has like slow convergence in high dimension, right? All those methods are sensitive to the dimension. And that's the problem that we are going to tackle here, the dimension of the parameter. So to give you a bit the intuition, in general, what happened is that the data is actually not informative on the whole parameter domain, right? It is actually informative only on or along a certain direction. Here it's denoted by the red arrow, okay? And meaning that the change from prior to posterior occurs only along a certain directions, okay? And if you the goal here will be to detect this dimension. And so here, if you try to formalize a bit this idea, if the data are informative on a low dimensional subspace, means that there exists a good approximation of the posterior distribution under this form, right? Where you have replaced the likelihood function by a function that looks like this. So it's a function of U transpose X, okay? Where this matrix UR is actually a low rank matrix, a matrix which contains only R columns, all right? So in fact, this guy here is sometimes called a ridge function, all right? And the matrix UR that you are using here is actually the key object to reduce the dimension, and it allows in fact to split your space into two parts, right? You have the image of UR, which is in fact the informed subspace. Which corresponds to the red arrow on this cartoon, and the kernel of UR transpose is the non-informed subspace, and in this non-informed subspace, the posterior, well, you believe that the posterior behaves just like the prior, all right? So that's what I mean by the non-informed subspace. So how can this help us? So here I represent the space split, okay, with the image of UR and the kernel of UR. So here, this cartoon, well, this picture is actually not very well representative of what happened with the dimension. Here, the image it looks like it's of bigger dimension than the kernel of UR transpose, but in fact, it's the other way around, right? The informed, well, what you expect is that the informed subspace will be smaller or will have a smaller dimension compared to the non-informed one. Okay, so we introduce now the notation XR for the informed component and XPERP for the non-informed components. And in fact, your approximate posterior looks like this. It's a product of an approximate posterior density times the conditional prior, all right? And so if you want to use an MCMC algorithm to sample from this approximate posterior, it's going to be actually quite easy because of the structure that you have here, right? At the first step, you, for example, use an MCMC chain or an MCMC algorithm that you run only on the subspace. So that is in principle much simpler compared to running your MCMC in the full dimensional space. And then what you do is that you draw samples from the conditional prior, and you sum up the two samples to get an exact samples from your approximate posterior. All right. So, in fact, this idea can be extended to sample from the exact posterior distribution by correcting the samples that you got. Okay, you can use, for example, importance weights or Metropolis scheme. But there are like other options here. Okay, so I'm gonna go back on this MCMC algorithm later on. But the objective here is again to find a structured approximation like this. Okay, so we're gonna we are looking for an L tilde and a matrix UR, which is such that the number of informed directions R is going to be much smaller than the ambient dimension D. And what we would like to do, of course, is to control the approximation error that we introduce. And here in this talk, I'm going to use the Kullback-Leibler divergence. Actually, the prime reason is that with this divergence, we can develop a lot of theory. Okay. So I'm going to show you first how to build this or how to infer the informed directions, and then I'm going to extend this work to the data-free case, right? So first, there is this result that tells you that if you work with a fixed UR, okay, if assume that UR is known, okay, or is fixed, then the optimal function L tilde that minimizes the Kullback-Leibler is actually given by this formula. So it's the it's a conditional expectation of the likelihood itself. All right, and as a consequence, if you put that expression into the expression above, you obtain that your approximate posterior should write as the product of the exact marginal posterior times the conditional prior. All right, so this is actually not very well surprising. Here you put you're actually using the exact posterior marginal posterior. But I would like to insist on the fact that this result here, it actually strongly depends on the choice of the divergence that you choose here. This works for the Kullback-Leibler divergence, but if you were using something else, like for example the Hellinger distance, you will get another function here, all right? So once we did that, we're going to use this result in order to build to infer the matrix UR. So this result tells you that if you are using a Gaussian prior, then you can actually bound the Kullback-Leibler divergence from the exact posterior to the approximate posterior by this quantity. And this quantity, it is a measure of the norm of the gradient of the log likelihood projected onto the kernel of UR, so projected onto the non-informed directions. All right, so and what we're going to do next is that we're going to build the UR by minimizing this bound. Okay, so let me just explain you that. So to develop this result, we have used the logarithmic Sobolev inequalities. So it's a well-known inequalities in functional analysis, right? And here it can actually be extended to more general distribution, meaning non-Gaussian prior here, by making stronger assumptions, by making some assumption on the prior here that you put here. And the only thing that you will lose in a sense is that you might have a larger constants than just a one half, okay? But in fact, yeah, this can be easily extended. All right, so now we're gonna build the informed, or we're gonna build the matrix UR by minimizing the bound, okay? And in fact, when you look at this quantity here, minimizing this quantity over UR, it corresponds exactly to doing a principal component analysis on the gradient of the log likelihood. So what you're gonna do is that you're gonna compute this matrix that I call HY, why? Because it depends on the data, okay? And this matrix is the outer product of a gradient of log likelihood times itself and averaged over the posterior distribution. Once you've computed this matrix using samples, for instance, using Monte Carlo approximation, you're gonna compute the eigenvalue decomposition or the generalized eigenvalue decomposition, because there is a sigma here on the right hand side, but you know, this is, well, you can think of this as being just an eigenvalue problem if you want, and you're going to put the largest eigenvectors as the columns of the matrix UR. This is how you build the matrix UR. And in the end, what you can do is that you can show that the KL divergence will be bounded by 1/2 times the sum of the remaining eigenvalues of the matrix H. So in a sense, the spectrum of H indicates whether or not your Bayesian inverse problem has a low intrinsic dimension. If you have a strong decay in the spectrum, then the answer is yes, your Bayesian inverse problem has a low intrinsic dimension, all right? So let me show you what happened on this benchmark. So this is an atmospheric remote sensing problem where you basically want to infer the density of some gas in the atmosphere. So you have here a starlight that goes through the atmosphere and that is captured by a satellite around the Earth. And depending on the spectrum of the light, you can infer the density of the gas in the atmosphere. So the forward model is modeled by the Beer's law. Here you have the formula, and here we are using a Gaussian prior for this experiment. And after discretization, the dimension of the parameter is 200. All right. So on this curve here, I plot the error as a function of the dimension, the inferred dimension. Okay, as a function of R. So here what we do is that we compute the matrix R, the matrix H, we assemble the approximate posterior, and we compute the KL divergence between the two. And this is the continuous curve that you have here. At the same time, what I do here is that I plot the error bound that we got. Remember, it was 1/2 times the sum of the remaining eigenvalue. And this is the dashed line that you have here. So see, you have a good concordance between the two. So you are, well, and the error decays quite fast. So you are happy with this result. But the only problem here is that, as I was telling before, you have to compute an expectation over the posterior distribution, which is exactly, you know, what is difficult to do. So instead of doing this, you might say, okay, let's say that I replace this posterior by some density rho. That is, for example, either the prior itself, that I know how to sample from it, or a Laplace approximation of the posterior. If you do this, then you will get a different approximate posterior, and the error will look like this. So it decays still quite quickly, but you can see that it's significantly suboptimal. So what we have proposed in this article is to use an iterative procedure that starts with rho being the prior distribution. You compute a first H, and then from this first dimension reduction, you build a first approximate posterior in order to recompute the matrix H here by putting this approximate posterior here. So if you do this iterative procedure, after two or three iterations, your algorithm has converged, and you are quite happy with the optimality of the subspace detection that you have. But in fact, the problem is that all of this procedure is data dependent, meaning that if you once you will get a new piece of data, you will have to redo all those computations. And as you can imagine, these are quite expensive computations. So there is a real gain in finding a dimension reduction which is independent on the data. And this is the data free words in my title. So here I'm gonna consider this new objective, right, which is to find a data free UR, okay, matrix which does not depend on Y, on the data Y, which is such that the Kullback-Leibler divergence or the resulting Kullback-Leibler divergence will be less than a certain tolerance, at least in high probability. And here high probability means probability with respect to the data Y, okay? And I assume in all this framework, I assume that the data, the capital Y here comes from it follows the law that is given by your Bayesian hypothesis, right? And okay, so our trick here is to use a Markov inequality that works as follows. So if you know how to bound the expectation of the KL divergence, okay, if you manage to prove that this expectation is less than epsilon, then you can be sure that this inequality holds at least with a probability greater than 1 minus epsilon over tolerance. Okay, so this is the way we're gonna attain this objective. Okay, by controlling the Kullback in expectation. So what we have proposed in our article here is to actually compute the expectation of the matrix H. So here again, it's expectation over the data. And if you know how to do that, you obtain a matrix H which is independent on the data, and you can extract from H a matrix UR by concatenating the dominant eigenvectors of H. Okay, so this is what we do during the offline phase, meaning we before getting the data. And next, once you have the data, you are in the online phase, right? And you want the computation to be quick. And so once you get the data, you're gonna use this dimension reduction tool in order to assemble your optimal likelihood function and run your algorithm to draw samples from your approximate cluster. Okay. And so if you do this, you can actually prove that the error in expectation or the Kullback-Leibler in expectation is bounded by 1/2 times the remaining eigenvalues of the matrix, the data-free matrix H. Okay. So now how can we compute this expectation of H? Well, you have actually a nice result that shows that this matrix H, it actually is the expectation. It can be written as the expectation over the prior distribution, so something that is simple to compute, of the Fisher information matrix. And I recall here the expression of the Fisher information matrix, which is, you know, the gradient of luck likelihood averaged over average over the likelihood density. Voilà. And luckily here, what is nice is that we have an explicit form for the Fisher information matrix in the case of a Gaussian likelihood, or for example, in the case of Poisson likelihood. And I give here the formula for these matrices. So you still have an expectation to compute, but this expectation is over the prior, which is something again that is tractable. So I'm going to show you here an example on this numerical elliptic PDE. So the goal is to infer the diffusion coefficient and the kappa s from pointwise observation of the solution. So we observe the temperature here on these black points, and the goal is to infer kappa, the diffusion coefficients. And more precisely, we are going to parameterize the problem by log of kappa, which is going to be x, and we're going to put a Gaussian prior again on x. And for the data, we again use a Gaussian likelihood. All right. So what we observe here is the following. So here I'm going to consider three pieces of data, so y1, y2, y3. I think it's the one that you see on the plot here. So case one, case two, case three. And I'm gonna show you the same curve as before, meaning the Kullback Leibler.
So you've got five minutes.
Okay, five minutes. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. So and what you see here is that on those on the three cases, the error behaves quite nicely. All right. And what happened if instead of choosing the data-free UR, I was using the one that is coming from the first piece of data? So if I do this, I will obtain something which is better, meaning more optimal in the case one. But in the case two and three, this UR obtained with the data one will be suboptimal. All right, this is nothing surprising, right? But the same happened with if you were using the Y2 and the Y3 case. So what so the message here is that you lose a little bit of optimality, but in the end you gain in generality, right? Because you can reuse your informed subspace for any observed direction, at least the three that we have here. All right. So very quickly, I'm going to talk about the sampling strategy here. So I'm going to go back on this cartoon where I was explaining that, using this dimension reduction, you can run an MCMC chain on the subspace and then complete your samples using samples drawn from the conditional prior. So in this case, what you have to do is that at each iteration, in order to run your MCMC on the subspace, you have at each iteration, right? You have to evaluate the exact posterior marginal, which is defined by this integral. So the trick here that we are proposing is to use an approximation, a Monte Carlo approximation of this integral, using an importance sampling here, using samples from the posterior, samples from conditional posteriors. All right. You can show that this estimator is actually a low variance estimator by construction of the matrix you are. In fact, if you properly choose your matrix you are, this is a low variance estimator. And here we're going to use the pseudo marginal trick, okay, that is proposed in this article, right, which consists actually in redrawing the samples that you use here to estimate the marginal posterior. So you redraw those samples at each MCMC iteration. And if you do that, you are in the context of what we call the pseudo-marginal MCMC, and your MCMC chain will be asymptotically exactly distributed as the, well, it targets the exact marginal posterior. And here the magic, which is quite surprising here, but what we have proposed is to actually recycle the samples that we draw here in order to get samples from the exact full posterior and not the approximate posterior as what we did before. And the trick consists in, instead of drawing conditional posterior here on at these steps, we recycle, meaning that we pick randomly. We subselect randomly the expert among the samples that we have generated before, and this is how we obtain an MCMC chain that targets exactly the full posterior distribution. I'm going to be very fast on this numerical example. Okay, so it's an X-ray tomography with Poisson data. So here we are not using a Gaussian likelihood and Gaussian prior, but a Poisson likelihood and a Bezier prior, just to show you that this methodology can be extended to non-Gaussian likelihood and non-Gaussian prior. All right. And here I was showing, I show you some performance, the performance of the MCMC algorithm measured with the integrated autocorrelation time. All right, so the smaller the autocorrelation time is, the better mixing you have, right? And here we are quite happy because by reducing the dimension, we can actually reduce the autocorrelation time compared to the full dimensional HMALA algorithm, which is one state of the art MCMC algorithm. I'm going to jump on the conclusion. So what I show you is a general method to detect the low effective dimension of a Bayesian inverse problem by using gradients of the log likelihood. And we have extended this work to the data-free case, meaning that we want to find the directions or the informed directions which will be informed by the data. Okay. And as an ongoing work, so we are going to, well, we are currently working on extending this methodology to reduce the dimension of the data, okay, not of the parameter. So that's something that you might be more in interested in, right? And there is a big question of how can we do the same methodology without using gradients of the likelihood, which is the expensive part of this works. Thank you for your attention, and sorry if I'm a bit late.
No, that's fine. Perfect okay. Timing. Yeah, that's fine. All right, if you'd like to, yes, okay. So questions from the screen and the floor. Very interesting. For Olivier,
who's
done all
the
Florence, thank you.
Yeah, hi Olivier.
Hi.
Thanks for the talk. So I was wondering, is there so basically you're assuming that you can actually reduce the dimension of your inverse problem globally. But yeah. I had the impression that in practice basically your parameters, they may be sensitive in some part of the space, and maybe other parameters may be useful in another part of the space. So could you, either use your method to detect that?
So,
and another question, could you have some kind of method that would be, that would be like region-based or...
Region-based,
the thing
is that the prime objective here is really to reduce the dimension. So, if you constrain or if you want to do something region-based, you are not exactly reducing the dimension. But one possible extension to this work is maybe to detect not a linear subspace, but maybe a linear manifold, meaning that instead of having of detecting a matrix UR. Transpose times x, maybe you want to construct a non-linear function that will sub-select features from your parameter x, right? So that's the one extension that we are currently looking at is the non-linear extension to that, right? So instead of looking for a flat subspace, we're going to detect a manifold, and again the point is to reduce the dimension so that is coherent in the case of manifold. Yeah. And the second part
I was wondering if you could basically you are going from some something which is optimal globally,
yeah,
but is suboptimal locally. Because you, yeah. So is
yeah,
there
yeah, a way? Yeah. I see.
Intermediate, like.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, okay. I think I got your point. In fact, yeah. What we can try to do is to find instead of detecting a subspace which is independent on the data, maybe we can build a surrogate model for this subspace to make it depend on the data. Maybe we can compute several different several views and this is definitely something we can do, yeah,
and to detect what are those regions on
this would be very interesting to do, yeah, I think.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Olivier? Let me just ask you a quick question. So when you did that approximation along the way as one of your steps to make things kind of feasible, your row distribution, and you did the Laplace approximation, I mean, yeah. How important is that approximation at that point? And, can you think about other types of approximations? That's an obvious one, but how have you assessed the sensitivity?
You mean the sensitivity of the matrix with respect to the density over which we are averaging it? Yeah, so not theoretically, but in practice, what we know is that you only need to have a rough approximation of the posterior. So, we were quite surprised because when I showed the Laplace approximation of the posterior, when we use the Laplace approximation of the posterior, at least on this benchmark, it was not performing quite well. But I think that the reason why is that in this particular benchmark there are like multimodalities which are not captured by the Laplace approximation of the posterior. But the idea is that yes, the answer is yes. We observe that if you are not sampling exactly from the posterior distribution, then you can still get a very informative. A very good subspace.
Yeah. Okay. Which mimics somehow strangely in a way that I can't pinpoint, the fact that you have this robustness prediction level to inaccuracy at the posterior level. So, it's interesting, isn't it? It's kind of a little bit of a recurring theme. All right. Okay. Well, that was very interesting. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah.